A very good morning to you and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies for today's meeting, and our first item of business today is a decision to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. So today we are going to hear from two panels as part of our inquiry into addressing child poverty through parental employment. Over the last few weeks, we have held evidence sessions on issues around childcare, education, training and employability programmes. Today we are focusing on employers. The need for flexible and family-friendly working was a very clear theme in addressing child poverty in the committee's recent call for views. And I welcome to the meeting our first panel of witnesses who will focus on policy. So we have Jack Evans, Senior Policy Advisor, Scotland, from Joseph Rowntree Foundation, Lynn Humdi, co-creator and programme manager, Making Work Work, the Challenges Group, and founder of Flexible Working Scotland. Nikki Slowey, director and co-founder, Flexibility Works, and Marek Semenak, senior public policy advisor, Scotland and Northern Ireland, Chartered Institute for Personnel and Development. And they are joining us in the room. And we have Jane Van Zyl, Chief Executive Officer, Working Families, who is joining us remotely. Thank you all for accepting our invitation. And a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. So we have roughly about 1 hour approximately to put forward questions to you. Virtual witnesses and members, please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. Please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. You can indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans if you wish to come in on a question. Don't feel that you have to answer every single question, and if you have nothing new to add to what's been already said by others, then that's okay as well. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? And I'm going to invite members to come in and ask their questions. So first of all, can I ask Paul to come in? Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. We're particularly interested in what is happening out there just now and what types of flexibilities, I suppose, are required. And really, to what extent are those flexibilities available just now to low-income parents? So I wonder if I could maybe direct that question first. And the convener has asked me to be quite specific in terms of how I direct that. So I wonder if I can come to Jane first. I'm just looking for a comment on the what's happening currently. So, and where are the flexibilities?
Hi, thanks very much for having me here. So, one of the challenges we think is that although many parents in Scotland are working flexibly, the challenge is many of them are working flexibly in ways that reduce their income. So, if you can work full time in a hybrid way, sometime in an office and sometime at home, that's really helpful. But if you're working flexibly, but that reduces your income, then that is an issue in terms of flexible working, because it doesn't mean that you have the right amount of income in order to prevent, for example, in this case, child poverty. There have been lots of studies done. I know Flexibility Works have done one in Scotland, and our research also shows that many parents are working flexibly. But the issue is where you are in low pay, your access to flexibility impacts your ability to earn money. It has the impact of reducing your income.
Thank you. I wonder, are there... how available, I think this is the key part of this question, is how available are the flexibilities for parents at the moment, particularly parents who are on low incomes. Are there practical examples that you could share of where, you know, things are working well?
Things are working well in the knowledge industry. So anybody who has access to work really using a computer, essentially, and anywhere where there is a tight labour market, but that is around what we would call, quote unquote, the talent. That tends to be people who are on higher incomes, but it's people on lower incomes who are working, for example, in retail, in logistics, in engineering, in hospitality, in education. Those are the people, and anybody working in a place-based organisation, so where you have to go to work. So, for example, literally from brain surgeons to cleaners, but the issue is that they don't have a choice about where they work. They have to go to where they work. And obviously, if they have caring responsibilities, either for a child or an adult, that therefore means that their ability to earn money is significantly restricted.
I wonder, Convener, then, just, I think, expanding from that point about how do we introduce that flexibility, what are the kind of effective ways of doing that, particularly where there are significant challenges on the ground? I'm keen to bring in other members of the panel, so perhaps Nikki might want to comment on how we grow that, essentially.
Yeah, we've been speaking to a lot of employers, but in the run-up to this inquiry, and asking them that very question, you know, what is it that we could do to support you? More examples, ideas, knowledge. They want to know how practically to do it. We find some employers are disinterested, but many are interested. They're just not sure how to do it, particularly in those sectors that Jane was talking about, where they've got frontline workers. They are really keen to know how they can actually create more flexible working. We have also been talking to frontline workers and finding out, well, what is it that makes a difference to you? They know that they can't work from home. Frontline workers know that. But what they are looking for is things like reliability of shifts, being able to set their shifts so that they know when they're always working. Occasional ad hoc flexibility for when emergencies arise within their family or situations arise. So those are the sorts of things that frontline workers see that they're looking for, and employers are saying that they want more evidence, knowledge and ideas of what they can do. It's just bringing those two things together, I think, we need to do to help employers, because we have to remember employers are running their businesses. So it's about providing support. And a number of the employers that we spoke to said actually practical support is what would be really helpful. We have worked hand in hand with a number of employers, provided that practical support, gone into their businesses, walked around their factories and given them advice and ideas and solutions about simple things like shift patterns, setting down shifts. And then we've gone back and we've seen the difference that that's made to those organisations. So I think that is the sort of thing that would be really helpful for employers, that practical support, that ability to learn from one another and to hear practical examples of what is possible.
Thank you, Kevin.
Okay, thank you very much. I don't know if anybody else wants to come in the panel. Marek, yep.
Thank you. I think one of the key challenges is very simply a lack of understanding of the various flexible working options out there. And that means both by employees and by employers as well. The pandemic has been great in boosting home and hybrid working. However, that's only one type of flexible working. If you look at the work that we've done in terms of what employees are looking for, home working is actually not on top of their list of priorities, of their preferences when it comes to flexible working. That actually tends to be flexi time. So having flexibility in when you start and finish your work day. One of those reasons there is, of course, childcare responsibilities as well. But there's broadly speaking about three different categories of flexible working, which is flexibility of where you work, that's your home working, flexibility of when you work, your flexi time, your compressed hours, and flexibility in how much you work, reduced hours, part-time hours, your four-day week, et cetera, et cetera. There's a very clear link between your income level and your occupation and the availability of home working to you. Both Nick and Jane have mentioned that already. Our research shows that actually those on the lowest incomes, so those who earn up to £20,000 a year, about 70% of those can't work from home and don't work from home at all. Overall, about 33% of all Scots cannot work from home, and 11% do not want to work from home. So that leaves basically half of all Scots for whom flexibility is not an option if you equate flexibility with home working.
Okay, thanks, Benoit. I believe Jane wants to come back in.
Thank you. I know we're focusing on employers, but one of the things that Working Families does is provide a free legal advice line. And what we find is that so many employees do not know what their rights are. As Nikki mentioned, employers are trying to run their business, and sometimes they just don't have the bandwidth to be able to provide the flexibility. But one of the things that we think is really important not to lose focus on is giving employees knowledge about what they have, what their rights are, and what they are entitled to, so they can have those conversations with their employers, particularly when they are small employers.
Okay, thanks very much, Jane. I'm now going to invite James, who's online. Thank you.
Thanks very much, and I think I'll ask my first question to Jack, then Owen. Okay. One of the things that seemed to come out of the pandemic was our ability for the workforce to work flexibly. What do you think we've learned from that experience? Jack.
Thank you, and thanks for having me today. So I think for many people, they learned that flexible working was an option, but for the cohort that probably JRF and others are interested in on this panel about child poverty, as has been given in the previous answer, flexibility wasn't on offer. Furlough was on offer for them. They took time off out of the labour market and then returned to the same inflexible, low-paid work that they were in before the pandemic. I probably think that the divergence between low-pay and higher-pay jobs has grown, that we're entering a system where we've got a class of people working at home and in a service industry servicing those same people on lower pay. And what I would say about that is that to think about the scale of what we're talking about today in light of the child poverty targets being predicted to be missed, as it was announced earlier this week, we're talking about changing the work conditions of around about 200,000 parents or 200,000 families. And flexibility is just one lever that we can possibly pull. And the last thing on the learnings from the pandemic is that the messaging matters. Messaging was key to ensuring compliance with pandemic COVID rules. Messaging about this mission for child poverty needs to penetrate into the business community and the private sector, as well as it has permeated within the policy and third and public sector.
Thanks, Mike. Lynn, would you like to come in?
Thank you, and thanks for the invitation today. I would agree with what Jack said, and I think one of the things that we're seeing now, and the previous question was about what's happening out there, is we're seeing a divergence between employers who've really grasped the learning from the pandemic and have really seen a new way of working and a way of increasing the diversity of their workforces and the ability to bring different people into their businesses, and those who just want to turn back the clock. And I think that shows us perhaps a deficit in management and in employers, that some managers find it easier to manage people they can see. That's perfectly understandable. But some of those managers have perhaps not been adequately skilled or trained to do that job. And it also shows us how difficult it is to maintain culture in a business when people don't come together. But I think we shouldn't, as Marek said, we shouldn't assume that flexible working means remote working. And there are lots of different ways that people can work a bit more flexibly or a bit more predictably. I think the pandemic showed us that the childcare sector needs a lot of support. And I think what we need to support, and let's be frank, this is a gendered issue. We're talking about mums more than dads, although the pandemic did show us that through furlough and sadly through redundancy, dads have been able to play a more active role in their families. But I think it's shown us that we need a triangle of policy levers. You've been talking about childcare, we're talking about flexible working today. We also need to think about getting mums back into the workplace. There is a high level of economic inactivity among mums, particularly single mums, and we know they are 90% of single parents, because flexibility isn't a nice to have, it's a choice between being in work or out of work. And we know women, and particularly women in lower paid jobs, were much more impacted by the pandemic. So we need to help those women who still are out of work because they were made redundant during the pandemic to get back in.
Can I ask just on that last point, Lynn, about childcare? Childcare, there seems to be a difficulty to have adequate childcare throughout the system. With flexible working practices, out with working from home, which Jack quite rightly pointed out I'm doing while many other people are unable to, but would flexible working help? Childcare seems to be expensive to roll out, seems to be difficult to get together, etc. Would flexible working take some of the pressure off the necessity for some of the childcare, except in cases like single mothers, etc., that wouldn't be the case, likely be the case?
The two things go hand in hand. I think if parents have the flexibility, for example, to start slightly later, they don't need to pay for a breakfast club if their children are at school. For example, I had to find an overnight stay for my son in order to be here today. I'm not a single parent, but my husband works shifts. If this was my daily job, it would cost me between £5 and £15 extra a day if I could find a place in a breakfast club to attend a job that started at 9 o'clock. But if I could start at 9:30, which I do, then that I don't have to pay that cost, and I don't have the stress of trying to find that place. I conducted a survey among some members of my community, Flexible Working Scotland. One woman told me an absolutely awful story. She's a single mum. She has a child with additional support needs. When he was 8 years old, so P3 or P4, she had to leave him in the playground for an hour before school started because she couldn't get any childcare. And she wanted to work. She wanted to be a role model for him. She wanted to get off benefits. And he had to... Luckily, she lived opposite the school. So after school, he let himself into the house for an hour before she came home from work. Our children shouldn't be in that situation, particularly not children with additional support needs. And parents consistently tell me getting childcare for disabled children, children with other additional support needs, is nigh on impossible. And those parents, especially mums, they say to me they cannot imagine ever being full-time again. And when women work part-time, they earn less because they work fewer hours, but they earn less because part-time work is paid less, it's valued less. There are employers who think, oh, you're part-time, you're not interested in your career, you're only kind of giving half the effort. So I think childcare and flexible working have to work hand in hand, and childcare workers have to have some flexibility.
OK. Thank you, Convia.
OK. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in. Yep, Jack.
Just one short point on the childcare question that was raised. The Scottish Government currently spend £1 billion a year on childcare. They've extended the entitlement to 1140 hours, widely welcomed, not always coming through for lots of people in lots of areas. But I think one of the questions we need to ask is, like, who shoulders the responsibility of childcare and flexibility? Where's the balance between the two? Are we, by paying for childcare, are we letting employers off the hook for inflexible anti-family practices? And should more be done with employers to amp up that flexibility so the cost to the state is lowered or can be directed to support parents and children in different ways?
Okay, thanks, Jack. I'm going to invite Jeremy in. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I wonder if I can maybe start with Lynn or Malik on this one. I'm interested to know about public sector jobs where you have to go, whether that's a hospital, a school, and often at weekend work where there's no childcare available. So if you're a cleaner or someone that works in the NHS, you know, you've got to work Saturday, Sundays. How do we deal with that type of issue where you've got to start at maybe 7 o'clock because that's when the ward changes? Are those types of jobs just not possible, or have you thought about any solutions around those type of jobs?
I think that's a really good point, and the public sector is an area where the Scottish Government has the relationships and the levers to make an impact. We have staffing crises in the NHS, in education, and those were the two sectors where, again, mums were telling me they had the biggest problems. And I absolutely appreciate that you can't have the ultimate flexibility. Nurses can't normally work from home, although I think we were all surprised that GPs can. And so there are innovations that perhaps we weren't expecting. But as Nikki was saying, predictability is so important in those jobs because people are being called in for shifts at short notice and they have no childcare. That means they do not get paid. Mums were telling me they had to pay for childcare in case they needed it. Now, the average cost of childcare for a day in Scotland, I think, is around £55. That's £55 that is not in that parent's pocket because they paid for childcare thinking they had a shift that day and they didn't. Or their partner was home, they didn't need the childcare. The inflexibility of childcare is a big issue for those professions. But also being able to plan ahead, to call in family members or to create relationships with other parents so you can help each other out. That can only happen if you know when you're going to be working. I think the other point is that the lack of progression opportunities. So even when people are able to find part-time work, for example, in the NHS or in schools, it prevents them progressing. Several mums said to me that they were kind of offered a part-time role because their manager knew them and they performed well, but it was made absolutely clear that they would not be promoted. One nurse told me she'd had to go down a band in order to get a part-time job and there was no chance she was ever going to go back up. Women tell me when they have one child, it's manageable to be a nurse. Two children, three children, just impossible. One of the women that came through our Making Work Work programme, she was a highly qualified nurse in intensive care. She had to give that up when she had her first child because the shifts weren't manageable. She became a research nurse. She had another child. It was about manageable. Her relationship broke down. She couldn't be a nurse. She had wanted to be a nurse her whole life since she was a little girl. So I think predictability in those professions is really important. Job shares are important and part-time work is important. And the Scottish Government has an opportunity to trial and test and really learn what can work for those organisations, but also for their staff in a staffing crisis.
Thanks, Lynn.
On the back of that, I think it's very clear that key workers, especially those, for example, working in the NHS, flexibility there is a lot more difficult, but it's not impossible. There are things that can be done. There are flexible working arrangements that NHS workers can make use of as well. There's ways you can manage rotas, for example, shifts being staggered, etc. I would echo what Lynn said around predictability. I think that's an absolutely crucial part of the picture. And she will not thank me for this, but I'll use my wife as an example, who's a paramedic. She, incidentally, is also on a flexible working contract. All the flexible working contract says is that she doesn't work one particular day per week, which helps us with childcare. But the thing that made the biggest difference was when she was put on a 14-week rolling rota system, so we now actually can see what the shifts are, going ahead years and years, and we can plan childcare around that, we can plan holidays, etc., around it. So that is absolutely key. I would agree with that.
Okay. Can I now invite Miles in?
Thank you, convener. Good morning. Thanks for joining us today. And I wanted to really look more in detail at what that flexibility looks like. And it was a good example you just gave there, Marek. But to what extent can the Scottish Government do more to ensure that these flexi working practices are put into place and become the norm in the public sector? And the example you gave there, Marek, I don't know for the NHS if that's just within the ambulance service or if it's being adapted wider in nursing. I certainly know a lot of friends who work in nursing that only by going onto the bank have they managed to get any control over their shifts. And that's far more expensive for the public as well to fund that. So just wondered if there's any other examples of what that can look like. Nikki, do you want to come in on that?
Yep. I think it's really important that the Scottish Government set a standard for the public sector that they can follow, that is expected around some of the things that have been discussed today, and really make that quite vocal. I think there's definitely something that can be done around about procurement of services. Obviously, in the Fair Work First framework, we do have offering flexible and family-friendly working practices for all workers from day one. So we were delighted and really pleased that that was embedded into the principles of Fair Work First. But we'd like to see that strengthened. We would really like to see all organisations that are in receipt of public funds really being held a bit more accountable for their commitment to flexible and family-friendly working, being able to really demonstrate that they are committed to flexibility, family-friendly working, and it's not just a tick box. So I think really holding them to account and setting some kind of standard is really important for the public sector. For government, really important to lead by example. Making flexible working the default for all jobs, unless it's really impossible not to be done flexibly. Advertising roles as flexible. Senior and public people endorsing flexible working, role modelling flexible working. These are all things, practical things, I think, that could be done realistically within the public sector. We've also still got at the moment a commitment around the 4-day working week trial in the public sector and an element of money that's been allocated for that. What I would like to see, what we would like to see at Flexibility Works is that trial and that money to be used to look at some of the other types of flexible working, not just the 4-day working week. So for some of these other sectors, like nursing, like healthcare, manufacturing, retail, let's look at those sectors and let's look at other types of flexibility and other jobs within the public sector, not just a 4-day working week.
Yeah.
I think that's important. It can be a real game changer for people, but I think we should be looking at a wider pilot in the public sector, utilising that money to look at other types of flexible working.
Yeah. Lynn or Jack, is there anything you want to add on?
One point just broadly on public sector and flexibility. The committee is obviously the role that we're looking at today is it's a flexible working's ability to reduce poverty, or flexibility and family friendly working policies to reduce poverty. 6% of people in the public sector work in the public sector in poverty, compared to 13% in the private sector. So the public sector is way ahead in terms of its poverty reducing ability via working in the public sector. So I think what flexibility is good in its own right and is important at all aspects, but if we're looking for solutions to child poverty, I think it's incumbent to understand what are those drivers for that small cohort of people working in the public sector who are in poverty. It might not just be flexibility.
And Jane, is there anything you want to add where to bring you in?
Thank you. Yes, just to support what everybody else has been saying, it is not just about flexibility. It's about having a living wage, living hours and predictable hours. And those are things that could be mandated within the public sector, and particularly in terms of the procurement that the Scottish Government has guidance on. At the moment, you insist on living wage, but having living hours would make a significant difference, particularly for people downstream in the procurement process. 40% of the Scottish Government's money goes to SMEs, and those have particular issues with how to manage that. Again, I'd support Nikki's view that the four-day week is great, but there are other things that we perhaps might be doing differently.
Okay, thank you. All my other questions have been covered, so happy to hand back.
I believe, Lynn, did you want to come back in?
Yeah, just one point, just to back up what Nikki was saying about really shouting about good flexible working practice. I think through its procurement, through its campaigning, the Scottish Government has an opportunity to really highlight not just public sector, but also private and third sector organisations where flexible working is really making a difference, and really showing that, you know, using organisations like Nikki's to really show where best practice works, because we know that some employers are worried about how to implement flexible working and they need those real examples. They may also need some training. But a key statistic that really illustrates this for me is that while, and Nikki knows how many people are working flexibly in the economy, but only 30% of jobs are advertised flexibly, and so many more people are actually in flexible jobs. So this means that organisations may be working flexibly and not telling anyone. And the women who I work with on our returners programme, for them, flexibility is a priority. 80% of them are mums. They need work that works around them and their other commitments. Women are having their kids later. We know about the sandwich generation where women are looking after their kids and their parents. They may have disabled children who they're having to look after as adults. And those women are looking for flexible employers. They're not even looking at the rest. They are designing their work-life blends around work they are able to do. And those employers are missing out by not shouting about the practices that they might be doing, but they don't necessarily realise that people are looking for.
Okay, thanks, Lynn. I'm going to bring Katie in now. Thank you.
I mean, I'd like to sort of ask the question from a sort of different angle. I mean, are there any Scottish Government policies that you can point to that are actually pulling in the wrong direction, in the opposite direction? Is there any, perhaps, that you could point to? I don't know if either Nikki or Lynn would like to come in on that.
Do you want to go first? I think there are some. The big one for us, the Challenges Group is a provider of support to women who want to return to work after a career break, and who we're now able, because we've identified that underemployment is an issue for women, particularly mums, we're now able to help women who are underemployed to change their working situation, because we know that when women go back to the workplace, they get trapped in work they're able to do, but which is maybe beneath their potential, their earning potential, their skills or their experience. And so I think in this whole conversation, we're forgetting parents who are at risk of poverty. For parents, particularly single parents, it takes one life event and that might completely tip the balance for them. It might mean they're unable to work, they might have to leave a job, a relationship might break down, you know, and particularly women, they're left high and dry. And so I think we need to not forget about all those so-called economically inactive women in particular, who aren't in the workplace. And the Scottish Government has been funding a Women Returners programme, which finished at the end of the previous financial year. And we're in a hiatus now where they're evaluating it. There's still a commitment to the gender pay gap. There's a commitment to combating child poverty, to helping families increase their income, but there's no Women Returners funding. And in our own situation, we're now receiving funding from the UK government in a devolved area to be able to support Women Returners. And I think we need to get rid of this assumption that women's careers are linear, that they have a baby and then just jump back into the workplace, because that's not the reality. We've worked with, the longest career break we've worked with was a woman who's out of work for 17 years. She has a disabled child, and it just hasn't been feasible for her to get back in. She is now back in. She's an engineer, so a very male-dominated sector, but she could have been contributing if there was better childcare provision, greater flexibility, and the support. After 17 years, it's easy to assume you've forgotten everything you knew. That is definitely not the case. And so we need that support to help women, just mums, from just being forgotten. And our economy suffers. The women suffer, but our economy suffers, because those women could be contributing. Women tell me it helps their mental health to be working, to be having adult conversations, to be using their brain. And those women have just been sidelined. So I think the Women Returners funding is a key policy that needs to be reinstigated.
Okay. Thanks, Lynn.
Were you wanting to come in, Nikki?
Yeah, I would just build on and echo what Lynn said. I've had the privilege to work with a number of women returners over the last couple of years that have been on some of the programmes that Lynn described, and the vast majority of the women that I've met have said that flexibility is one of the reasons that they have left the workplace, lack of flexibility. And they've also said that it's a critical criteria for returning to the workplace. And they talk about the value of these programmes and the peer-to-peer support, the confidence building, the building of knowledge. My part in these programmes is very small. It's delivering a half-day workshop about flexible working. But in the main, the women say they'd no idea of the different options that were out there, their legal rights. So I think these programmes are vital to give people the confidence and the knowledge, because it's so hard to know where these flexible jobs exist. I would like to just mention employability very briefly. 90% of unemployed women say that having control over where, when or how much they work would make it much easier to get a job. But as Lynn said, around about 30% of jobs in Scotland mention flexible working. Over half of Scottish women say they wouldn't apply for a job if it doesn't mention flexible working. So we know flexibility is not a silver bullet, but we know it's really, really important for the cohort of people that we're talking about. So then we go on to look at employability programmes. And there's a lot of really good work going on and a really lot of investment from Scottish Government in employability, and particularly parental employability programmes. But we really need to make sure that we're building in flexible working knowledge for the people who are providing these contracts. So that's not about just any job we'll do. It's about finding a flexible job for people. And I think we should be expecting that to be built into the programmes. I think we should be asking people who are in receipt of employability funding to report about how are they providing that advice to people who are looking for flexible working. How are they negotiating with employers in their local areas about flexible jobs? I think that would make a really big difference to some of the employability programmes to have this built in, both in terms of influencing employers, but also the people who are going through the programmes, making sure they've got the knowledge that they need about how to find flexible jobs.
Thank you.
Katie, have you got any further questions?
No, that's fine. Thank you. That's helpful.
Can I invite Gordon in? Thank you.
Thanks very much. I've got a number of questions that I want to ask, but I'll start off with the questions I've been given before we move on. So I'm keen. We've heard this morning, and I want to come to you first, Marek. We heard this morning that we need flexible working, we need good job design, and we need better quality of jobs. And we heard last week from the IPPR that the only real power Scotland has is soft power, and it's effectively just marketing PR, like the business pledge that we had, which had a reasonable take-up, but not great when you bear in mind there's 109,000 businesses with around one or more employees in Scotland. So my question is, you know, if, as you said in your evidence, that in practice what we need is good line management, what's the role in the Scottish Government in that? I mean, did it have a role in fostering best practice, bearing in mind we've already went down the route of the Scottish Business Pledge?
So there's a few points to make. Job quality is quite a broad concept. There's various different aspects to it. Pay, of course, is very important. Hours are very important. Security of contract, etc. But there's other aspects and elements to job quality that we do quite a lot of research on as well. The Fair Work Convention does a lot of research on as well. In terms of the Scottish Government's power, yes, there is the soft power. There is the power of the Scottish Government as an employer, of course, as well, and in serving as a role model to not just the public sector, but the private sector as well. The government also has a role to play in terms of, for example, supporting more research into the relationship between job quality and things like productivity, so not just employee well-being, but also employee performance and therefore organizational performance, because ultimately, if, and there's more and more research out there that actually shows this, if you persuade businesses that investing in job quality is not just good for the employees, but it's good for the business, well, that's your golden ticket, I think, right there. Now, you are right to mention management, and we mentioned in our submission as well. Good line management is absolutely key to unlocking various aspects of job quality, but flexible working in particular as well, because it is good line managers that can speak to their employees and pick up on some of the concerns and some of the needs that they might have, and then be able to navigate, for example, official flexible working requests through the legislative route. Where the government comes in is, of course, through the business support services landscape. Most of the things that we have in place through Scottish Enterprise or SDS are mostly targeted at sort of growing businesses. Your Skills for Growth, for example, very much aimed at sort of larger small businesses who are trying to grow. Now, if you look at the statistics, you've got about 85,000 micro-businesses in Scotland, so that's those that employ between 1 and 9 employees. Those employ about 300,000 people in Scotland. Now, there is no intervention to try and help these businesses with their management quality. What you could do is, for example, look at something that the CAPD has done, which was a people skills project, where our members gave up some of their time to provide direct one-to-one management support to some of these smallest businesses. There's a pilot that ran in Glasgow a few years ago. The evaluation of that was extremely positive. It was oversubscribed in terms of demand. That is a very clear way to try and reach the sort of long tail of mostly unproductive, some of the smallest firms in Scotland.
Sounds like a mentoring system. I mean, you know, why you said it was a pilot. Why wasn't it continued?
That is not a question for me. It was a pilot that was ran jointly with Glasgow City Council. Yeah. I believe. I'm not quite sure why it did not continue.
Okay. Before anybody else comes in, I've got a couple of questions for Jack. What's needed to ensure private businesses are fully engaged in policy debates around fair pay and family-friendly working?
So I think when you asked the previous question, you talked about IPPR's response, talking about marketing, soft power. First, it's important to remember that that was the situation we had in when the Parliament unanimously agreed the child poverty targets, and that we shouldn't underestimate that power. And that power is currently being underutilised. We have a great wealth of evidence, and we're very good at describing the problems in the labour market, and we are also building up a great evidence of what the solutions are. The missing step is convincing businesses about why they should be concerned about what all that evidence says. Where are the enlightened areas of self-interest that businesses can hear that a flexible contract can help a worker progress in their career, they not lose the talent that they so desperately need in their organisation, that also ensures that children are less likely to be in a poverty in a working household, because at the moment 67% of kids in poverty are in a working household. So that kind of lack of tactics, I think, is what we would see in how to get the information out to business that is created and generated in the kind of policy sense and in Parliament and in research institutions all over the UK. The very helpful Spice paper highlighted the kind of three ways that that's happening at the moment. They said the business pledge, which hasn't been active since 2020 and is going through another reboot. Living wage accreditation, fantastic success. Side note, I used to work there, so I would say that. that is seven people working to engage businesses on a specific issue, and then sector strategies, and highlights retail, which is in its infancy. That needs to be massively grown if we want to have any chance of convincing the private sector that they are part of this mission to end child poverty and that we can all benefit from it. And where I would start, like Mark, I think looking at those, the size of business, but we also know 50% of all people in work poverty are in five sectors. So where is the strategy to interact with retail, hospitality, administration, health and social care services, and arts and entertainment? That's where the cohort we're worried about is. Where's the information coming to them? Where's the funding to go and speak to those organisations about family-friendly working, flexible policies, living wage, living hours, all of that? So that all that is soft power. That's all carrots, probably, rather than sticks. But again, when we talk about not having the powers, that is referenced a number of times here and today, I'm not sure what powers people would be talking about having to implement to change this. Because if it was, for example, the living wage, we know if the living wage was implemented to everyone currently below the living wage, that would be fantastic and reduce poverty, but it would only reduce child poverty in our research by about one percentage point. So you've still got a significant way to go before you get to 2030, and you've got just one in 10 kids in poverty rather than, you know, 18%.
Yeah. Can I ask a slightly different question, if I may, convener? Jack, your organisation, Joseph Rowntree Foundation, was a signatory to a letter in April to Lord Callanan, and it was to do with implications of the retained EU law revocation and reform bill. And there was a number of parts to that, the part-time employees, prevention of less favourable treatment, maternity and paternity leave, etc. Can you just emphasise what your concerns are?
So I think maternity and paternity leave are something that hasn't come up yet, but must be foundational to this conversation about family-friendly working. There's currently about 8,500 children in poverty because their parents are, while their parents are on maternity leave. Maternity leave is set at a statutory level. The UK level is one of the lowest in the OECD, and after the first 6 weeks, you go to about 170 quid. Way too low to have a decent standard of living and causes poverty in some instances. I don't see the reason why we couldn't, in Scotland, come up with a kind of gold standard, a suggestion of what a proper maternity, anti-poverty maternity policy looks like. My experience working with employers is if you give them nebulous or kind of vague ideas, they're less likely to follow on. A good example of that is in procurement, when we say pay the living wage and don't use exploitative zero-hour contracts. What we've seen is amazing take-up of the living wage because it's a positive request, whereas we've seen zero-hour contracts increase to now we have the highest proportion of zero-hour contracts per capita within the four nations. Because we didn't give employers the standard, we just said don't use them. So with maternity and paternity pay, I think we take that learning and say, well, what is a way to evidence what a good maternity and paternity policy level would be to make sure that people aren't falling into poverty and therefore when they're on that maternity leave, they're not stressed and worried and they're more likely to dip out and stay out of the labour market for longer. On the specifics of the letter, I probably need to follow up with my colleagues as well.
Fine, thanks. Anybody else want to come in on any of those three questions? Yeah.
One, thank you.
Just a quick point. I think the Scottish Government funds a lot of organisations to speak to businesses. You know, Marek was talking about productivity. There's the SCDI Productivity Club, for example. Nikki's organisation receives funding. There's a plethora of them out there. The issue is about mainstreaming these ideas around child poverty, around flexible working, so that the same messages are passing through those organisations and the Scottish Government is signalling that this is an important issue for businesses. The UK Parliament, which obviously has the powers to legislate around employment, is about to bring in the day one right to flexible working. And we need to be preparing Scottish businesses for that. We have some businesses who are already going way beyond that. We have some that it will be difficult to drag to that point, but this will become law. And so there's a real opportunity, I think, for the Scottish Government to use the organisations it's already funding to prepare businesses for that point. And we know the law is kind of like the floor, if you like, and we want some of them to reach the ceiling, but at least we could be helping them to do that.
If I can just add some numbers to what Lynn just said, we've done some research on the day one right to request flexible working, and across the UK, 49% of businesses do not know that it was coming in. This was a few months ago. Out of those who are not already offering a day one right, 46% say it will be quite difficult for them to actually implement this. So there, you know, I think it's a great thing. We've campaigned for this for many years as well. So it's a great thing that it is actually coming in, but businesses, A, need to be more aware of it, and B, probably will need some support in how to implement it. And just if I can follow up on what Jack said on the maternity and paternity leave policies, just to speak up for fathers, the paternity leave policy in the UK is appalling, and if there is a priority to try and address it, would be this, and that can also help with the very gender nature of care, and a sort of slightly linked issue to that is this shared parental leave, which simply is not working, I think, on any measure.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Jane wants to come in.
Thank you. Just to support what Jack and Marek have been saying, we've recently done some research with low-income parents. And on average in the UK, women will take 9 months maternity leave. But for low-income parents, that reduces by 4 months because they simply cannot afford to stay off work with the level of maternity support supplied. And I would echo what Marek said. You know, if you take paternity leave, that's at £174 a week. That's pitiful and unaffordable for most low-income families.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Can I now invite... Come in.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for your time this morning. Most of my questions are covered, so it's really not on this theme, but the evidence we've taken suggests Social Security rules are frequently cited as barriers. In fact, our briefing today repeats this. It's been said that the conditionality regime in UC hinders options for flexibility. Jack, do you have any observations on that point?
I'm afraid I don't, to be honest. I would probably pass to one of my colleagues.
Social Security is not an area that we deal with, I'm afraid.
Thanks. Lynn, you kind of touched on the pilot of the four-day working week. Do you have any kind of further views on the merits or issues of such a pilot?
I think it was you who mentioned the four-day.
Nikki, it was, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of global evidence around the success of a four-day working week, particularly for countries that are trying to move towards a well-being economy. But most of the pilots have been done in knowledge-based sectors. And that is the slight concern, that we're not really looking at how would we implement such a way of working in more frontline-based roles. So I think I have no companies that do a four-day working week. Some of them are here in Scotland. They're doing it very successfully. The people that work for them have a great working work-life balance. The companies are seeing increases in productivity, or certainly no decreases in productivity. But we need to widen out that. And we need to look at not just putting all our eggs in one basket. So the four-day working week is one type of flexible working, but there's lots of other things that I think we should be looking at. Money's tight, so if there's going to be any pilots of flexible working models, I think we should be looking wider than just a four-day working week model. And I think we should be, if we are just going to look at a four-day working week, we need to be really clear that we have to widen it out to sectors beyond desk-based, knowledge-based sectors.
Thanks, Lynn.
Thanks. Just to add to what Nikki was saying there, you know, one size doesn't fit all, and the four-day working week won't work for everybody or every business. And what's really key in this whole conversation, I think, is we're talking about how to get the best out of our staff. If our staff are stressed, if they're worried about their kids, if they are feeling burnt out because they're working more than they feel able to do, if they are parents with disabilities or they're neurodivergent, you know, there's an intersectionality of issues that also impact parents. And employers should be looking at how to get the best out of their staff for their business, and that involves talking to their staff and not assuming that they impose one way of working and it's going to work for everybody. And so it's really critical to listen to staff and to understand their lived experience, because people typically want to give their best, but the structures and the barriers prevent them from doing so. And I think I'm definitely not an expert on universal credit, but what parents tell me is that there's a really difficult line between they want to increase their hours, but there's a point at which that impacts their benefits and it's just not worthwhile, especially when they have childcare costs. And universal credit covers, I think, 85% of childcare costs, but that's sometimes not enough.
The most important thing when it comes to the four-day week is we need more evidence. Nikki is right. There are examples worldwide where it seems to have worked. There was a well-publicised trial across the UK as well. However, these trials tend to be more skewed towards certain sectors where it is a lot easier to implement. There are still the same challenges with maintaining productivity for employees and employers as well. And truthfully, sometimes the results of the trials tend to be overwritten a little bit in the headlines. When you look at the actual outcomes and the results of the trials, it's perhaps not quite as overwhelmingly positive as might be suggested. That being said, there are some very positive signs, but we need a lot more evidence. We've been looking forward to seeing the Scottish Government public sector trial, and I think I will still waiting for it to be announced.
Okay. A further point, Nikki.
Just to say that in our experience, most of the things that we're talking about can be achieved with small changes. It doesn't need to be headline grabbing, huge change like moving a company to a four-day working week. When you are given the privileged position of going in and working with an employer and understanding their business and they trust you to do that, sometimes just making the smallest of changes can have a really big impact for the workers within that organisation. Simple things. Now, I know we're talking about parental employment today. I worked with an employer recently, and in conversations with their workforce, I realised there was a number of older workers who were on the verge of leaving because they'd never seen anyone else. They're in a factory and they'd never seen anyone else on the factory floor working part-time. So simply by able to say to the managing director of that firm, this is a situation, he said, what will I do? And I said, well, could you offer part-time contracts to these workers? And he did for the first time, and he was able to retain about four or five workers who would have left. Small change. It doesn't need to be all huge change. But what you do need to do is, and this is employers telling us that they do need to be given that support. Sometimes that means funding for organisations, so that organisations like ours and Maddox and Jack can go in and Jane's can go in and work with employers to help them realise what these changes could look like.
Thanks for that, Nikki. Not to leave you out, Jane, do you want to come in with anything? Any points? Or?
Thanks very much, Mari. Yes, I'd like to. Working Families recently employed a benefits advisor. And in the last financial year, that single benefits advisor working part-time was able to get £100,000 in unclaimed benefits for working parents and carers. 40% of people on universal credit are in work. And that meant, on average, the people that she spoke to had an additional £2,500 a year in terms of income. And that's going to make a significant difference to those people on the lowest possible incomes. There's £1 billion worth of unclaimed benefits within the United Kingdom. So that is, again, something that I would really encourage government to look at funding. That's just on the UC. For the rest, of course, I completely agree with Nikki and Marek and Jack.
Thanks for that, Jane. I'll hand back now to convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's interesting, Jane. And we've got the Director of Social Security next week, so we'll challenge him on that as well. So that's us came to the end of all our questions, unless any other member has any questions they want to come in on. So can I just thank the witnesses for the evidence that you have given today, and I will now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for the setup of the next panel. So thank you very much, and thanks, Jane. I know you're online. Thank you for joining us today. Welcome back. We're now going to hear from our second panel on employers, with a panel of business representatives. I welcome our witnesses, all joining us in the room. And we've got Andrea Bradley, General Secretary, Educational Institute of Scotland, representing Scottish Trades Union Congress. Karen Hedge, Deputy Chief Executive for Scottish Care, and Louisa McDonnell, Scotland Director for Business in the Community. And I'm now going to invite our members to ask questions. So I'm going to invite Katie. Thank you.
Thank you very much. My first question, I think, probably is better directed to Louisa, which is, how do you think that the Fair Work agenda, Fair Work, can best be moved forward in the current economic climate? What's your thoughts about that?
It's very interesting. I also sit on the New Deal for Business group with the Cabinet Secretary, and we're having this conversation. I co-chair the Wellbeing Economy group, and business in the community has been around for about 40 years. Champion responsible business, how employers show up in the world to be fairer and to be greener. And what's really interesting at the moment, obviously, there's a lot of economic challenges. And the simple way to get through to businesses is to demonstrate the commercial case for being responsible. So a lot of what we're talking about and discussing, and we do, this is all we do, we're a UK-wide charity, is show the commercial benefits for treating your people really well. And often that can show up in a variety of forms. We campaign on a range of issues, including childcare and parental rights and things like that. But we also challenge the members that we work with, who would generally, though not totally, large employers across the UK, to show up better in the world and to come together as a community and what they can do and how they can champion responsible business together. So there's a range of ways. One is to work with larger organisations within their supply chains. That's one thing we can do. Government can show up as a good employer itself and set the agenda and encourage to follow. And I know that you're particularly interested in procurement. That's definitely one way to do it. There is a lot going on already. But one of the recommendations for the Wellbeing Economy Group will be to combine what's going on in public procurement but also best practice in private sector procurement, because there is actually a lot happening. So awareness raising is a big part of it, and there are lots of ways to do that, but it's hard.
So we obviously are living in difficult times. It's particularly difficult times for working people, given the pressures of inflation, particularly with food, fuel, etc. So if I can maybe ask Andrea, I mean, it's quite clear that in some sectors, in the private sector in particular, trade unions are actually getting some very good deals, particularly after an industrial action, and that might be associated with labour shortages. So how do you think a tight labour market can lead to improvements in family-friendly working? I appreciate you're more in the public sector, but maybe if you could speak in the round, both about the public sector and the private sector.
Sure. So I think that the current economic context should and could incentivise employers to do what they can to attract workers, specifically around what they offer in terms of pay, but also in terms of what they offer relative to flexible working. And the STUC would wish to see these changes done on a negotiated basis, all workers potentially being able to benefit from that, rather than continuation of the UK government's provision for individual requests to be considered and potentially rejected. Relatively recent survey work by the TUC involving 13,000 working mothers indicated that only 50% of them had their flexible working requests granted. And similar research, 86% of mothers who do work flexibly faced discrimination thereafter. So even granting of requests doesn't mean that working lives are then free of issues. And we know that there are real inequalities across sectors and pay grades in terms of the distribution of flexible working. The workers who are most likely to experience in-work poverty as a result of underemployment, for example, are the least likely to have access to home working that enables better work-life balance and, you know, balancing of childcare and so on. And I think in terms of Scottish Government, there's an opportunity now, given the conditions right now, there's an opportunity to support employers towards making the kinds of improvements that we need to see for the longer term. Maybe just to pick up on a couple of the points that Louisa made there. Certainly, the Fair Work Convention is a good start. It's a good start in Scotland that other jurisdictions of the UK don't have. But we are still seeing similar distributions of poverty and in-work poverty in Scotland as we do in the rest of the UK, which underlines for the STUC that the Fair Work Convention and the whole kind of organisation of Fair Work has to have more teeth than it does at the minute. We need to see mandate in the short term, you know, greater mandating around procurement, the issuing of grants, etc., in the short term. And in the longer term, I think that we need to see the devolution of employment law to Scotland in order that we can legislate for so much that the Fair Work Convention at the minute aspires to achieving.
I think we'll be moving on to issues around about procurement and contract compliance later on. But in terms of the labour market, I mean, in some sectors, you know, retail, manufacturing, you're seeing quite high pay increases actually as a percentage. Public sector is a bit different. But of course, for the employee, it's the whole package that matters. It's pay and all the other terms and conditions, such as flexible working. So to what extent is flexible working part of those negotiations at the moment? And do you think there's more that could be done there?
Well, certainly the STUC has on its agenda, as does my union, to do more around flexible working in the interests of particularly women workers, but all parents, in fact, in order that they can better balance the responsibilities that they have to their children and their family lives and the responsibilities that they have to their employers. But you describe there the fact that there have been wins within retail, hospitality for trade unions. That, I think, is indicative of the fact that public sector pay is lagging behind that of the private sector, and the Scottish Government has got a role to play in equalising that so that we don't see that kind of hemorrhaging from, for example, sectors like care towards hospitality and retail in pursuit of better pay and fairer working conditions that have been negotiated through collective bargaining. But you know, I think that for all the fact that there have been some wins, these have been hard fought often. These have been hard fought, you know, within the various sectors, and I think what we need to have is the kind of foundations that enable more collaborative working between trade unions and employers, such that we don't see industrial action scenarios that then ultimately, you know, in most cases do force better outcomes for workers. But we would like those to be achieved without, you know, the industrial action often involving strike action and disruption to services occurring, having to occur first, and workers being forced into taking that kind of action.
And obviously they lose pay when they do that. And maybe if I could bring Karen in then about the care issue, because we definitely we hear quite regularly about people leaving the care sector maybe to go into other sectors like retail, because actually they're going to earn more there. So what scope do you think there is for increasing flexible working for frontline workers, particularly in the care sector?
If you don't mind, I would actually really like to answer your first question as well in that context as well. And that was about recognising fair work in the current economic climate. So one of the challenges that we have in policy setting and social care is it's very much isolated. It's considered unto its own and not joined up with other strategies and policies within Scottish Government. Say, for instance, the 10-year economic strategy, despite the fact that social care contributes more to the economy of Scotland than agriculture, forestry and fishing. So it's the third largest contributor to the economy in Scotland, but it's missing from the economic strategy. So there's something there about joining that up and stop siloing the sector into one place. There's also a need to recognise the impact of monopsony purchasing in the sector. So when we can pick this up when you get to the procurement and tendering bit later, but actually, does competition law actually exist in a sector where there's only one purchaser? And that's what drives the challenges that we have in the ability to pay our staff more. Flexible working actually is something which does exist in the social care sector. It's why I'm sitting here today. I could pick up flexible hours whilst I was at university, and that's what drove me into social care, because I found a career that actually I absolutely loved and adored, and that's what led me here. So I think there are plenty of opportunities for flexible working in social care. It's a 24-hour service, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. So this is about having honest conversations with your employer and having opportunities for real effective voice to enable that to happen.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in. No. In that case, I'm going to pass over to Marie. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I just wanted to ask how effective are accreditation schemes like the Scottish Business Pledge, living wage and living hours, and what would you sort of think would make them more effective? And I'll pop it out to Louisa first.
Fascinating. The business in the community doesn't do accreditation. The reason being is that you can have all the policies in the world, but culture eats policy for breakfast. So you can have a big long list of policies you've got. Yep, done that, tick box. But actually, if you don't implement them, socialise them, make them the norm, then it's a tick box exercise, literally. So I'll give you an example. So one of our members is Phoenix Group, who has a large footprint in Scotland because they've taken most of the Standard Life pension business into their organisation. And I had a really interesting conversation with one of their inclusivity managers a few weeks ago, and she said that they were doing a staff survey about policies, and what came back was that 60% of men didn't think that the parental policy, parental leave policy applied to them. So they were really shocked by this, because men said, well, yeah, but if my wife's doing the caring, then why should that apply to me? And similarly, almost 50% of caring is not children, or you might not be a parent, you could be a grandparent. So they were quite shocked by this, and the way that they've gone about it is to really socialise the impact that their policies have and to bring them to life and to make them happen. So they're on a progress, a journey to do this. And cultural change is always a journey. It's not just having a policy in place, it's actually making it live and breathe. So I'll give you another example. So Aviva, again, a large employer in Scotland, they introduced equal parental leave about 4 years ago. And when I say equal, I mean completely equal. And they socialised it. And 50% of the take-up of parental leave now is equal between all the carers. They've saved money in recruitment costs because people can stay with them for longer, they can have better careers. And people are more productive when you've been in a job for longer. So although it costs a lot to perhaps do it initially, the long-term results is that you have the well-being of your workforce and the productivity, if you want to be really sort of business about it, goes up.
Thank you. Anyone else? Andrea?
Thanks. So accreditation schemes clearly incentivise some employers, but from our point of view, largely already good employers, you know, for example, Aviva. And, you know, that volunteerism clearly isn't working as effectively as we need it to, given the stats that I quoted just, you know, in the previous question from those couple of TUC surveys. And another bit of work done by the Equality and Human Rights Commission revealed that 1 in 9 mothers are dismissed, 11% are made compulsorily redundant, where others in the workplace are not. The number of fathers taking paternity leave fell from 213,500 in 2017-18 to 170,000 in 2020-21. So that clearly would underline that volunteerism and accreditation schemes are not working as effectively as we need them to. So more effective from our point of view, and as we'd see in the Nordic models, would be government policy to support and deliver sectoral collective bargaining in line, for example, with previous and yet unmet recommendations of the Fair Work Convention around social care and construction, and generally the strengthening of Fair Work First guidance for direct funding and procurement to require employers to recognise trade unions to co-create effective collective bargaining mechanisms that would deliver effective flexible working arrangements. And we also think that government could be looking at things like non-domestic rates relief. We think that that should be reformed, making trade union recognition, collective bargaining and flexible working absolute conditions of granting. And I think we also need to see monitoring of adherence to the terms of the Fair Work Convention and adherence to the terms of any kind of accreditation schemes, because there's maybe a relative ease with which these things can be achieved and granted in the first place, but what happens in the months, the years, you know, following that accreditation or that awarding of a grant and so on. And longer term, again, we think that devolution of employment law will be critical to tightening up in these areas and delivering better for workers, and particularly workers with families who are trying to balance both sets of responsibilities. So I think overall we need to see a shift from voluntary accreditation schemes to more government mandating around grants and procurements and legislation in the longer term to deliver and protect around these areas.
Thanks for that, Andrea. Karen, do you want to pop in there before I move on?
Sure. So we actually surveyed our members earlier this year about their ability to deliver living hours contracts, and 90% of them said they wished they could, but they can't due to tendering practices. And part of that is due to the time and task commissioning. And it causes huge challenges. We have providers who are having tenders that are being rolled over since 2018, being paid the same rates that they were being paid in 2018. So they have that inability to hold on to and retain their staff because they can't pass the same Fair Work terms and conditions on in that way. But I know we'll come back to that. But I thought that 90% statistic would have been helpful in this context.
Thanks for that. My next question is kind of covered slightly, but you know, how best can the Scottish Government encourage and support businesses to do more on fair and family-friendly working? And obviously you've touched a bit on that, Andrea. Anyone want to expand a wee bit on it? Louisa?
I think there's a partnership to be had here, the raising of awareness. On the one hand, government could lead by example, both in its own approaches to the culture that it has, particularly around mandating that men can take flexible working to create a better equality and a reduced gender pay gap. But business can bring a lot to the table as well, particularly those who are striving to be more responsible employers. It's not a given that legislation works in terms of bringing to the bare minimum. So I think there has to be a bit of stick and carrot. So again, going back to my original point, is if we can demonstrate the business case for fair work and well-being of your staff and flexible working and all that that entails, then that's just as powerful as a way to do this. Whether there's a role for government within that is a question that we're asking, but certainly it can lead by example.
Thank you. Karen, do you want to come in on that?
So we've currently been working with Edinburgh University on work around about healthy working lives and how we can support our workforce, particularly our older workforce as well, as many of them have dual caring responsibilities. So there are a few pilots ongoing. I can certainly send over what's been happening in that to the panel, if that would be helpful thereafter.
Yeah, that would be really helpful. Thanks for the answers. It's obviously, of course, the case that, you know, encouragement can only go so far, but I think the elephant in the room here is obviously mentioned by Andrea that, you know, employment law is not devolved. Andrea, the SCC, as you know, believe employment law should be devolved. If it was, what could the Scottish Government do to secure a fairer and more flexible employment landscape?
So I think it's some of the things that I talked about. It's the mandating around union recognition, having mechanisms across all sectors for sectoral collective bargaining. It is things like awarding facility time to trade union reps who currently don't have it, for example, equality reps, who are absolutely critical to this kind of work. I think that we would also wish to see the Scottish Government really invest in the facilitation of trade union employer collaboration around some of these issues, ensuring that those who are affected by the decisions that are taken about how work is arranged are properly consulted about job design, you know, about arrangements for working hours, etc. And of course, trade unions are a brilliant conduit, you know, for that kind of engagement. You know, we would wish to see that kind of thing. And I suppose, you know, the aspirations that are captured within the Fair Work Convention, we would like to see more of that translated into legislation. But Louisa's right, legislation on its own doesn't necessarily deliver on the objectives. It's all of the support, the ongoing support and resourcing that's required around that. So, for example, the Scottish Government in, I think, just the last 2 years or so has been operating some pilots around a four-day working week, but we haven't seen much emerge from that. And I think that that's an area that we could really take forward as a country. I think that that really, you know, speaks very strongly to the, you know, the wish to move to a well-being economy and to have, you know, just better outcomes in terms of balancing of work and family life. I think that you know, that's an area that definitely could be, you know, could be mined much more than it has been to date.
Thanks, Andrea. Your points are very helpful. Anybody else want to make any comment before I hand back to the convener? Karen?
Yes, please. So I absolutely agree about the conversation about effective voice and sectoral collective bargaining in this space, but I do have concerns about the conversations that are currently going on about the way that collective bargaining could be implemented in social care. So at the moment, the proposition is that for the independent sector, so that's charitable, private and employee-owned organisations, will sit separately from statutory sector negotiations. Yet because the funding comes from statutory sector organisations, the agreement still has to come. So one might come up with a different figure from the other. So it's almost like a false creation of sectoral bargaining, which sort of undermines the system, really, and actually, you know, reinforces that undervaluing of care workers who are in the independent sector. So I really think a lot of work needs to go in to come up with something better in that space that's co-designed with the social care workforce. Secondly, when decisions are made about the terms and conditions and the rate of pay for social care staff, it needs to be done within the context. So we know last year, of course, the announcement of the uplift to social care workers actually brought them in at less than what a cleaner gets paid in a hospital. And the reason that that's difficult is because social care workers are professionally registered and they have to have qualifications to undertake that work. So the message that is given actually is one which suggests that they're not as worthy as those working in the NHS. So it's much, much bigger than, you know, just terms and conditions. It's also about the message that we give and how we value our staff.
Thank you. Louisa?
Thanks. I totally agree with Andrea about monitoring. I think, yes, you can have your policy label, your business pledge tick. One of the things we do with our members when they come into membership is we do a responsible business tracker. So we work with them over a period of about 6 months to look at all the indicators of being a responsible business, whether that's staff wellbeing, community engagement, you know, all the impacts of your own environmental processes, whatever you do, and then we look at where you're failing most, and then we work with you, and we come back in 2 years, and we measure your progress. That's one of the things that we do. So I think monitoring is incredibly important. But I would also sound a note of caution around devolved employment, adding an additional layer of burden to UK-wide businesses, because it gets confusing. It adds an additional level of cost, and it can do, and it's cumulative. And that's one of the things we're looking at in the new business thing, to look at the cumulative impact of all of these different levels of business regulation. And how do we work with that? So although we'd very much welcome a conversation about employment law, I think the note of caution would be that it has to be in a UK-wide context, otherwise you're going to get unintended consequences. One of the other things that's come out of the other thing that we've been discussing is that the term wellbeing economy is extremely confusing. It means different things to different people at different times. So the businesses that we've been talking to are generally within our networks, and it's myself, a B Corp convener and a CDI. But we work with businesses who are quite engaged. So one of our conversations is around how do we get beyond the usual suspects, and actually terminology and jargon in particular, and wellbeing economy is a jargon phrase. Why not economic wellbeing for everybody in a fairer and greener world? You know, it's how do you make it straightforward so that actually you get more buy-in along that journey? And it is a journey. You can't just do some publicity about it, right, 6 months and then just leave it, and everybody should know this is an ongoing journey, and it has to be cumulative in terms of understanding and where you go from there.
Thanks for that. Can you do it?
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to invite Jeremy in. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you all for coming along. Just a couple of questions to kind of go on further now. Will the strengthened field work requirements in the public sector contracts and grants result in better paying conditions, do you think? I don't know who wants to start.
Was it me? Sure,
I got all mine.
You were green a minute ago.
Does anybody want to come in?
Am I green?
Have I got all mine?
I'm green. Sorry. Okay, I'll start.
It's a beginning, I think, is the answer. Yes, it will help. And socialisation of what it means and how to implement it is extremely important. And also, as I said earlier, it can be leading the way. But it's more about how do you help, particularly the smaller businesses who are tendering for public sector procurement contracts, how do you help them to that point? So there's a range of things that are going on, but sometimes it's a bit, we were talking about this before we came upstairs, it's a bit chicken and egg. How do you implement that, which has an upfront cost, which will eventually lead to long term? So it's a question of investment. So public fair work can definitely help and get the ball rolling, but it's not the only part of this conversation, and it should also be ongoing.
Okay.
I think it's me. So I think to some extent... Oh, not you. Right, it is red. It's not when it's green. Oh, is it me? Okay, thank you. Okay, so I think to some extent there could be enhancements to pay and conditions with the strengthened arrangements, but STEC believes that these could and should go further, and it's around the areas that I've already talked about. There should be requirements around union recognition, around collective bargaining and flexible working provision. You know, these should be mandated. It's back to the point about monitoring, ongoing monitoring, to ensure that there is sustained adherence to these elements. And I think that we need to be really cognisant of the fact that low pay and in-work poverty are endemic in Scotland. These are endemic to Scotland and, of course, the wider UK. But Scotland has had the Fair Work Convention in place now for some years, and yet 68% of children in poverty are living in households where at least one adult is working. So I think, again, we need to look towards things like non-domestic rates relief and potential reform of that. That to ensure that businesses who are benefiting from that provision recognise trade unions and provide flexible working. We've already talked about the need for changes to employment law. And in terms of, unintended consequences around fair work and the different procurement arrangements that there are, I suppose there's the potential for employers, public sector employers, to sidestep fair work requirements themselves by contracting work to other providers who are not bound by those arrangements. And I think that the Scottish Government, in recognition of all of this, could be looking to the Scottish Child Payment to increase that to £40 a week, as many anti-poverty organisations are proposing. And they could also boost family incomes by offering universal free school meals from primary one to S6, which would save £425 per year as a minimum per family per child. So I think, given the restrictions that there are around Fair Work at the minute, and the fact that we don't have mandates as strongly as we would wish, there are other things that the Scottish Government could be doing in the meantime to alleviate poverty.
Karen, can I ask, maybe start with you for this question, if that's okay? And that is, how has the Scottish Government's social care policy affected pay and conditions in the independent social care sector?
So the rate of pay, or the minimum rate of pay, is set by Scottish Government, how much is paid for our frontline social care staff. In the care home sector, we have a cost model which effectively dictates how that would be spread out across other people who work in the sector, so differentials and so on, though it's applied to a 50-bedded home. So if you have a care home that's smaller than that, then to be able to maintain those standards is impossible. And at the moment, we're seeing one care home close per week. So the impact is huge. It is not possible to maintain those Fair Works and standards. For care at home, it's even more challenging. And that's raises the question of just popping something into a contract if you don't actually create the conditions to enable Fair Work terms and conditions in the front line. Actually, where does the responsibility lie? And you know what I'd said earlier about people receiving the same rate of pay for the service that they're delivering since 2018, it's just not possible to pass that on. And that's why we're seeing care homes closing at the rate that they are, and care at home organisations are having to hand back hours, which then means we've got great levels of unmet need in the community, which impacts people who work because they're having to uptake caring responsibilities as well in that space. As for the Fair Work First, speaking from an organisation who does receive grants from Scottish Government, we are now sitting in June and we are still waiting on some of our grant letters. And we weren't prepared. Obviously, I know that this is coming because I'm working in that sector and promoting Fair Work across social care. But there was no preparation to say that this was coming as part of your grant contracts. No conversation or discussion about how we would implement it. It was just given, here's your offer letter, you need to sign it, off you go. So there needs to be more priming of those people who are in receipt of those grants and an opportunity to step up to the mark.
OK, I mean, I think there's so much there to unpack, but I mean, I suppose in regard to that, I mean, how from your experience, you know, if you're an independent home care provider, so, you know, for the record, I get somebody that comes in every morning to give me a hand to get dressed. Do those organisations, you know, that kind of company, how much are they involved in this? How much do they know about it? If you're just trying to make your, you know, your business doing your day-to-day work, is there proper communication going on at that level down to your kind of local company in Perth, Edinburgh, Glasgow, wherever it is?
So those conversations will happen in a few different ways and a few different aspects. So the commissioners at the local authority level or the health and social care partnership level should be having conversations with those that they contract with. As a membership organisation, we have over 900 members. So or we represent over 900 organisations with about just over 380, I think, members. So we have those conversations with our members, and I actively update them on what's happening on the Fair Work agenda. The other place that these conversations would take place would be through the Care Inspectorate. So the inspection regime actually looks at workforce and how providers are maintaining and supporting their workforce in that place. So there's a few different areas where this would be done, as well as the SSSE, who's a regulatory body for the workforce themselves, I know is raising the voice of the workforce in that space. So it is coming to members from quite a few different areas. I guess the challenge is how do we create those conditions to enable them to enact this? Because from our surveying of members, there is a desire to do so. They recognise that to retain our staff, we need to be doing this. But it's how do we do it within the current economic challenge?
I suppose, just very finally on that one, ultimately what you're saying is unless there's an increase in the uplift, then this is all going to kind of cause more and more problems. Ultimately, it's a financial choice that has to be made here.
Absolutely, but also, you know, beyond the commissioning authorities as well. So thinking about the HMRC payment for mileage, it hasn't increased since 2011, which has actually seen providers having to make a choice not to pick up visits that are at a longer distance. And of course, then that causes other poverty issues for people not being able to get that service that they deserve. So the knock-on effects are actually much, much bigger. So we have to think about, you know, what's wider than just the commissioned aspect of that.
Thank you,
Camilla. Okay, I'm now going to invite Gordon in, and then I'm going to bring in Katie. Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Camilla. I've got one question I want to address to Louisa. You highlighted, I think, in an answer to Marie, that you had concerns if there was a devolution of employment law, because UK businesses want certainty and uniformity, if I picked you up correctly. My question is, that, you know, we're looking today about improving the financial situation of low-income families, and we've got different political makeups in Cardiff, Edinburgh and Westminster. Is it therefore acceptable that the consequence of looking at that uniformity and is that more progressive policies are delayed and take longer to be introduced because we have to move at the slowest member, i.e. Westminster?
I think that's a very interesting question, and there's no real answer to that because it depends on political imperatives, and I'm not getting into that. What I would say is that being mindful, I think, is probably what we would ask. Not necessarily slowing it down, but you know, if you're looking to implement more progressive policies in one place, actually, what else can you do to talk to equivalent bodies in other jurisdictions around what they're doing? Wouldn't that be just a sensible route to go? So not saying do this or don't do that. I'm saying actually, can we be pragmatic about this and just have a conversation at earlier stages in order to come to a resolution? But that doesn't necessarily mean holding back to the slowest implementation. You can always take the lead in something, but actually it would be sensible to just bear in mind what else is going on.
Anybody else want to comment on that? Yeah, Andrea.
So I think we've seen from recent experience that the, you know, the kind of dialogue that Louisa is hopeful will lead to the kind of outcomes that we would wish to see would be sufficient, you know, to deliver, you know, fairer working lives for the people of Scotland, for example. I'm just thinking about the UK government's intervention relative to the Gender Recognition Act and so on. I think that a recent experience of collaborative working or just working with Westminster has not been a positive one. So from an STUC point of view, we would wish to see Scotland in control of the levers that are going to have the greatest impact on the, you know, the pay conditions, working lives of people in Scotland. And so it's for that reason that we would wish to see the devolution of employment law to Scotland. We think that would stand us in much stronger stead to be able to deliver on the kinds of aspirations that are captured within the Fair Work Convention, but they are not. That's a convention. It's a convention, and it's by voluntary agreement, and we need to see strengthening, around all of the arrangements there if we're to deliver on so many of the agendas that we are all signed up to: closing gender pay gaps, closing ethnicity pay gaps, reducing child poverty, delivering a well-being economy, delivering a just transition that truly is just. Control of employment law is absolutely integral to that.
Thank you. Karen, you got anything to add?
I wanted to say that was a week past Wednesday I was here at the Women in Business Committee, and there was a presentation on the gender poverty pay gap as well. I don't profess to know much, it's not my area of expertise, but certainly they were saying that there is a gap around about £350,000 for women, and there was a reason why it was a devolved issue. So if I can go back and get some evidence from that and submit that as well. But we've not covered pensions, and I think it's important to raise in this context.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Can I quickly bring in Katie, and then I'll bring in Miles.
Thank you. No, thank you for that. And I was wanting to pick up on some of the issues that were being raised round about contract compliance, conditionality and procurement. And there was specific mention to non-domestic rates. And of course, there's been quite a lot of discussion in some places anyway about the possibility of using land taxes, speculation-based land taxes, sometimes called an Amazon tax, but it wouldn't necessarily just be Amazon, to use land taxation as a way to raise funds. But that could be linked potentially to some of the issues that are being raised here. In terms of legislation, we've obviously got new procurement laws that have passed in England and Wales. So they've moved away from the European model, and our understanding is that, you know, that will mean, for example, that local councils can put conditions on contracts, for example, by local contracts. So therefore, you know, they could also put conditions in relation to some of the employment issues that are being raised here. And I just wondered whether that's something that you've had the chance yet to look at. But also, my understanding from speaking with tax and accountancy experts in relation to other countries, that fines are potentially a large way that some countries raise funds, whether that's environmental fines or related to some of these issues. And I just wondered if those also were issues that you'd had an opportunity to look at and were giving any consideration to in relation to these issues and how we get companies in Scotland and, you know, incentivise, if you like, companies in Scotland to carry out some of the public policy requirements we have in terms of terms and conditions of employment. I don't know if Andrea would want to come in on that first.
So maybe not so much to say on some of the intricacies of those new procurement arrangements, but certainly in relation to taxation, the STUC believes that the Scottish Government could be doing more to raise revenue for investment in public services, such that they would be better placed to deliver on the aspirations of Fair Work, including around flexible working arrangements, etc., and you know, decent pay for staff, particularly in the context of the majority of public sector workers being women, and the disproportionate impacts of poverty and in-work poverty on women. So I think that there's a really strong connection between the healthiness of our investments in public services and our ability to deliver Fair Work, and that is absolutely linked to taxation, and how we essentially have to do more to tax wealth and to tax the corporations such as Amazon, you know, who utilise you know, so much of what Scotland has to offer and the workforce here in Scotland, but to our minds are not paying enough in terms of you know, contribution towards these kind of social responsibility objectives that there are around the wellbeing economy, just transition, and so on.
Okay. Does anyone else want to come in on that? Karen?
We have had members coming to us within the last couple of years saying that they're having to change how they're purchasing. So normally they would go to their local organisations to purchase, you know, from the butchers and so on. But they're no longer able to do that, and they're having to move to larger bulk purchasing organisations. And again, this comes down to having to make efficiencies. So the National Care Home Contract rate then has a further efficiency, despite being a model which is itemised, then has an efficiency rate applied to it. So they're having to shift the way that they're purchasing, which is against, you know, the principles of the wellbeing economy. And that's what brings me back to that original conversation about not considering social care in isolation from the other policies that are being set, because they're all interwoven in that space.
The Scottish Government decided to opt out of the procurement legislation that went through Westminster, and because it wants to stick close to European regulations, because that's the policy. But obviously this Parliament could regulate in relation to procurement, and I just was wondering what that might look like, what you would like that to look like. Or maybe you don't want to go down that path, but what would that look like? And it's something that I'm very interested in, so I just wondered
It is something, particularly, you know, the majority of care providers in Scotland are small family-run organisations. They've built up within their local towns and villages, so they are used to having those local networks. And I think the legislation would enable that to happen better, but again comes down to what we're seeing with Fair Work Terms and Conditions. Just popping it in a contract doesn't necessarily allow it to happen. You need to create the conditions that enable that to happen and to see beyond the just that bit of social care in isolation. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Can I now bring in Miles?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to ask a few questions with regards to Just Transition, which has been raised. And a lot of our conversation today has talked about higher employment of female, for example, in the NHS, social care, education. But it was interesting, the submission from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation pointed out that 72.2% of green jobs are currently held by men. So I wanted to ask your view on what needs to change to specifically, I think, around workplace training opportunities, and just to capture your views on that. Andrea, I think you raised Just Transition. So.
Yeah, so I think that what you're describing there, Miles, kind of mirrors what we know about STEM sectors generally and how we have a disproportionately low number of women working in STEM, in spite of the fact that in terms of undergraduate study and so on, we have quite healthy gender balance. So that would suggest that there's quite a lot of work to be done by employers in that sector and beyond, you know, into the Just Transition sector in order to sufficiently recruit but critically retain women workers. And I think some of the reasons why we see leakage from the STEM sector and probably why we're seeing that mirrored as we move towards net zero is that there are inbuilt discriminations, biases, prejudices that culturally make life difficult for women workers in the sector, and we need to continue to work to overcome as much of that as we possibly can. But there are structural barriers, for example, relative to the lack of flexible working to enable women to balance childcare and other caring responsibilities with their responsibilities as employees. So these are things that have to be ironed out. It's not going to be a just transition without these things being properly considered and these hurdles properly overcome for women. So I think that the design and organisation of training, to go to your specific point, should be done in conjunction with trade union reps, who are operating in these sectors and who know their members, communicate with them and can represent their views. And we need multiple options in terms of training patterns and ways of accessing training that workers can meaningfully access. At all costs, we need to avoid the discrimination and exclusions, that we see already being baked into net zero transition. Otherwise, as I said, it won't be a just transition. So we need to support workers across the board, and particularly underrepresented groups such as women, to take part in training. So, for example, suitable times within the working day, or if they are beyond the working day, then additional payment for that. Suitable venues, covering travel costs, providing or paying for childcare. These are all things that employers can do to ensure that women are not left behind in all the training work that needs to go around the transition to net zero. And again, I think equality reps and union equality reps can assist with designing training arrangements that are inclusive of all workers. And I think that all of that should be underpinned by equality impact assessment. And trade union reps, again, specifically equality reps, are very well versed in operating those and working with employers to make sure that they are not just bureaucratic exercises, but they are actually delivering well for workers. Because it's not in the interest of employers to have sections of the workforce untrained in the areas that they need to be upskilled in.
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. And we've had certain examples of different businesses who have tried to encourage people to go into industry. I think the college sector has also got a key role to play in this. I certainly know some of the visits I've done to some of the fantastic new renewable industry training opportunities. Again, it seems that it's young men coming out of school who are really focusing on going into that. So I just wondered, Louisa, if you have any examples of where businesses can really get this resolved earlier on in these new, really exciting industries which offer great career opportunities for people.
Yes and no. There's the issue is wider. It's more about gender inequality than anything else. So, you know, in order to help businesses, one of the things we need to do is establish caring as the norm, not the exception. And we need to target men for flexible working. So that's, and that's not just to do with green jobs, because green jobs has an expanding definition. So, you know, it could be a financial services person who runs, you know, a premises, and they have to look at the net zero impact of that thing. But that wouldn't be a green job under current definition. So I think talking about green skills is probably broader, and I think your point about training is very interesting. It's not specifically to do with green skills, but one of our members had a real challenge with recruitment and retention, particularly of engineers. And they had a 43% turnover rate of staff. And they couldn't recruit the engineers they needed. It was a food processing company in the UK. But what they realised was they couldn't just implement a training programme. It just wouldn't work, because the majority of their staff were low-skilled, low-paid, and actually had really negative experiences of learning, particularly at school. So they had to take a step back and actually encourage the expression of things people had learnt that wasn't necessarily to do with work. So they implemented, they called it a passion for learning, and they sat around at lunchtime and anybody could talk about their hobbies. What was it? And they got guitar playing, they got floristry, but people were excited, and I learnt to do this and I learnt to do that. And all of a sudden, the idea of learning became normalised. As a result of that, they then moved that on to the next stage, and they took their basic operators and created a little pathway, now that learning was more acceptable, and gave them basic training on the machine operating, beyond operating and into repairing. And it came with progression, it came with pay once they increased pay once they completed the programme. Their productivity increased because their machines were offline a lot less, because they could grow their own engineers. Their recruitment and retention went down from 43% to 2% of staff turnover by creating an internal culture that was really positive around learning. So although it's not directly to do with green jobs, it is to do with transition. Now, I don't have a difference between male-female take-up of the engineering sort of pathway, but that is one creative way that an organisation recognised its challenges and overcame barriers to learning. So I think, you know, looking at learning more broadly in the round, you know, that we've had a project that's just been launched yesterday, I think, with digital skills fund, apply for digital skills. Well, what are digital skills? Does it just mean using Office properly? You know, what is the definition of that? Or does it mean I have to code? How do we transition, particularly low-paid workers, away and give them skills that are going to improve prospects, but we take away a fear of learning? So a lifelong learning commitment is really, really important, and also making flexible working equal and making it the norm, and carrying the norm for is everybody, and starting at that point and then taking it forward from there.
Yeah, thank you for that. And we heard previously around how businesses can benefit actually from having that flexibility around staff retention and moving towards that. I wanted to ask a question, Karen, and we've discussed this over many years with regards to people sometimes not seeing the skill set they have. If they've had a career break, for example, to bring up a family, to care for a loved one. And some of the work, I think it was Fife Council had done for people over 50 who had been in that position and then got them to go fast track into social care, and just wondered where flexibility then exists for that, because I think one of the things we know from workforce challenges is that a lot of councils don't necessarily want people to work part-time because they want them full-time for the current problems we're facing. And just wondered if you have any examples of where that's starting to change, both in the private and public sector.
Do you mind if I answer your just transition question?
Sure,
as
yeah,
well?
Go for it. Yeah.
So Healthcare Without Harm published a report saying that health and social care combines the fifth largest contributor to greenhouse gases in the world. So this is a really urgent problem for the social care sector, where there's absolutely no disaggregated data collection currently.
if you look at evidence from the Women's Budget Group, they talk about the key role that social care has to play as a green sector, and that might help your 72% male characteristic straight away if you start to incorporate a sector which is majorly female run and delivered. One of the challenges that we have, though, is that policy making happens again in isolation. So grants that are available through Business Energy Scotland don't actually lend themselves to the social care sector, which is mostly family-run businesses. So I have members who are in touch with me at the moment, a husband and wife who own a care home, really common setup in Scotland, but not able to apply for that funding because more than 25% of their business has another shareholder, i.e. husband owns 50%, wife owns the other 50%. So they are not able to access any investment that would enable them to introduce green policies. So there are wee bits and pieces that happen out there that could easily be addressed from a policy-making level that would enable us to progress in that just transition space. So there's also the role to consider that care staff have in supporting people who live in their own homes to live greener life should they wish to as well. But you have to consider the context when, you know, over 40% of social care staff are themselves accessing food banks. So we can deliver the training to do that, but actually are they capable when their mind is focused on when they're going to get their next meal themselves? So I just wanted to put that in there, that social care is thinking about just transition, but actually we're struggling to make it happen in reality. As for the flexible working side of things, yes, absolutely. We're hearing more and more people are having those conversations. Just yesterday at our AGM, this was a topic of conversation between particularly two organisations in Fife, funnily enough. So it's definitely a hot topic in Fife, and many innovative things are happening in Fife and social care at the moment. And it really is just as simple as having a conversation with your staff. What can we do to enable you to work more flexibly to retain? There is such a workforce shortage in the sector at the moment that providers are, you know, will really do as much as they possibly can to enable staff. And if flexible working is one of those things that they can do, then they're absolutely going to do it. I think what we could do as an organisation is to support more of our members to do that.
Yeah, thank you for that. I know we've run over time, convener. One of the issues which I thought was really useful in the first panel was around actually the ambulance service changing their rotas to give predictability. So I don't know if you could write to the committee maybe with examples of you have of that. I think it's a really important piece of work for us to look at, but thanks very much.
Okay, thanks, Miles. I'm quickly going to bring in Paul and then we'll bring it to an end. Thank you.
I'm very grateful, convener. This is a very quick question to Andrea about the place of trade union learning in terms of lifelong learning and what more can we do in that space so that trade unions have the resource they need to support workers to learn in the workplace and be have protected time to do that, essentially.
Yeah, well, trade unions in Scotland have, for the most part, enjoyed strong collaboration with the Scottish Government, really, I think, since the early 2000s around union learning with, annual grants awarded by the Scottish Government to support that union learning. In recent times, that there's been an element of precarity has crept in around that, and that's caused some concern about Scottish Union Learning's ability to continue the offer that it makes to affiliates of the STUC, and has caused real consternation amongst affiliates about the extent to which they are going to be able to rely on Scottish Union Learning funds in order to be able to sustain the offer that they are making to their members. Certainly that's been the EIS experience over the last six months or so. I'm glad to say that just in recent weeks it's been confirmed that grants it will continue for this year, but I think it would also be good to reach a position where that's not on an annualised basis. You know, that kind of there's an inbuilt precarity around that. I think that we need to, as the original legislation around Scottish Union Learning and learning reps and the really important role of union learning reps, since the inception of that legislation in the early 2000s, I think that we need to recognise the value that brings and invest in it in a way that gives security and sustainability to all of the people who are involved in that, either in delivering Scottish Union Learning funded learning or in receiving it. It's a big, you know, it's a big part of the union learning experience for workers in Scotland, a really valuable resource, I think, and one that should be protected and if anything expanded upon as we look to move towards net zero. I think that there's a huge role for unions to play in supporting workers in terms of upskilling and perhaps moving from one sector to another. But to come back to the point that that Miles was making about you know, just the disproportionate kind of number of men within, you know, within that sphere. Also really important here is the recognition of the huge undervaluing that there is of women's work, and that's already been touched upon very slightly in some of the contributions that we have made. I mean, you know, caring has to be seen as a fundamental, you know, essential public service, and the people who are delivering that service need to be treated with dignity and respect and properly remunerated for the really essential work that they do. In order that, we are sending a message as a society about what we value, you know, not only in terms of the workers who are providing that care, but the people who are receiving it, our citizens who are receiving it. We want them to receive it with maximum dignity and maximum quality, and I think that the whole kind of union learning experience around that is really, really important as well. It's not just about the pay, the conditions, it's about the opportunities for professional learning for people who are interested in coming to work in the care sector, and it's also about the people who are already in the sector, and union learning is an essential way of retaining those really valuable staff.
Nice, Camilla.
Okay. Thank you very much. So that concludes our public business today, and I'd like to thank all our witnesses for taking part and sharing your expertise. It's been absolutely invaluable. So we'll now move into private to consider the remaining item on the agenda, and thank you once again for coming along